Now, as the flood crisis continues across southeast Queensland and northern New South Wales, thousands of people found themselves trapped as waters continue to rapidly rise. The project's co-host, Hamish MacDonald, is on the ground in Chindera, just south of Tweed Heads in northern New South Wales. Haim, good morning to you. Thanks for joining us. What's happening where you are now?
Good morning to you guys. You can probably actually hear the helicopter overhead. There's actually still... We don't really know how many people waiting to be rescued. Just south of the Tweed River, we're in a place called Chindera. There's about three really low-lying caravan parks just on the edges of the Tweed River. And hundreds of people, we were told yesterday, remained there. A lot of them elderly residents that were waiting for assistance evacuating. We got the formal evacuation notice that was sent through via text from the SES around about 4 o'clock yesterday afternoon. But I've got to say, if you were one of those residents that received that, it would have been very difficult at that point to actually get out. So the rescue operation has continued through the night. The RFS has been in, taking people out in those large fire trucks that can get through the water, but also a lot of those inflatable dinghies that the SES has, that they've been brought in to pull people out. There is an evacuation centre set up at Kingscliff. We believe there's another one a bit further towards the north, towards Tweed Heads. That's where they've been taking people to. But as far as we understand it, there's still a lot of people stranded. And in fact, the SES on the local radio this morning was saying that they had been overwhelmed with the number of people using the phone service overnight where you can register to have yourself rescued. So clearly there's a big operation underway. You can see the level of the floodwaters behind us. That kept continuing to rise overnight. We were being told initially that the Tweed River would peak at around 8 p.m, then they were saying 10 p.m. Then as we tried to get a bit of shut-eye last night, they were saying that it would peak around midnight. We reckon it's maybe gone down just fractionally this morning, but it is still very high, and vehicles aren't able to get through at the moment other than those big RFS trucks, Sarah.
Well, and Hamish, you drove through the rain bomb yesterday. What was that like?
Pretty phenomenal, Tristan. I mean, you sort of hear them talking about it at the Bureau of Meteorology, but when you're in the middle of it, you realise that they're not really making it up. It was ferocious. It was relentless. We took off from Brisbane yesterday morning trying to get to Lismore. Obviously, things just became impossible to move further. It all happened so rapidly. I think that's what's quite interesting about this. Probably 20-25 minutes south of Brisbane Airport, you started to hit those rains, and it was just absolutely ferocious. And clearly, people that, you know, are living in it, you know, it's not as easy for them to get out. But that weather pattern, as we're being told, has moved a bit further south. There's been a little bit of sunshine here this morning, but the rain did continue a little bit overnight. And the areas of concern this morning clearly are around Ballina, with those new evacuation signals going out to West Ballina particularly, and then further south towards Grafton as well. The whole region, actually, Tristan, is under threat. And you got a sense of that actually driving south from Brisbane yesterday. Clearly, that city was still very much facing the threat of the floodwater, then onto the Gold Coast, then here to the Tweed River and the Northern Rivers areas. It's much the same picture. You just sort of see cars floating along. You see people on stand-up paddle boards, in dinghies, in motorboats, in areas that would normally be sort of traffic areas, essentially. That's the picture stretching all the way south from Brisbane.
The pictures coming out of that area are just so devastating. How are locals holding up?
Look, I think it's a really mixed picture, Sarah. There's obviously, you know, different kinds of infrastructure, different kinds of housing. Some people have homes that are built on stilts to sustain themselves against flood waters. And you do see, in fact, not very far over in that direction, there are people that are, you know, sitting out on their top floor balcony just trying to wait this thing out. But then there are others that live in more low-lying areas. Maybe the property is not designed as well, or it's an older property, for example. They just aren't able to stand up to this quite so well. And then there's obviously a lot of temporary accommodation. You know, there's people that live in caravan parks up here for long stretches of time, and often those are on the flats, low-lying areas that have just been absolutely inundated. But, you know, just behind us at the moment, there's some people with a horse trailer. You know, they were trying to get the horses out to safety yesterday afternoon. They thought they'd be able to get through. They were in a low-lying area. They thought they'd be able to get to the Tweed River and across onto the Gold Coast. And then, you know, things just changed pretty rapidly and they weren't able to get through. When you talk to people, that does seem to be the scenario that people find themselves in. You can really understand why it is that people end up on their rooftops, because they make a plan A, a plan B and a plan C. They think that they've got, you know, things under control, and then the water level swells pretty fast, and then they find themselves not able to get out or move themselves from the location that they're in. And then to move beyond that, they're really reliant on the SES, and that's a slow process. You know, there's community members here with jet skis that have been helping the SES, just to ferry small groups of people out one by one. Yesterday afternoon, we saw people using stand-up paddle boards to get their cats out, to get their bird cages out. One set of brothers that we met yesterday afternoon said they were just waiting for Noah and his ark to turn up and get them out.
So got a sense of humour at least. Hamish MacDonald, thanks for the update, and we'll catch you on the project tonight. Stay safe.
Thanks, guys.